There are a lot of things that can kill you in the world of Hyrule, whether that be getting whacked by enemies, struck by an unsuspecting bolt of lightning, or even just happening to miss that last final Guardian laser parry. So unsatisfying. Although the degree these attacks exist on varying magnitudes, how exactly is player health loss of all these actions calculated? And better yet, how does a player's armor level work in defending them against these attacks? As these armor numbers are never really explained in the game, and therefore deem meaningless besides simply higher number good. But if you're here, then you likely want to know more about the details behind how this all works. So today, we are going to dive deep into the hidden stats behind all player damaging methods in the game, between different types of enemy blows, elemental attacks, and even environmental ones like fall damage and lightning, in order to explain how player health loss and defense works in this game. So without further delay, let's get right into the stats. For starters, the first general thing we should understand is how the player's health bar works, which should be a slight recap from a previous video. Although we see this health meter represented by hearts, in comparison to an enemy's health meter that is represented by hit point numbers, the hearts that we see are actually just a fancier way of showing off a player's current hit points, as one heart is equivalent to 4 HP, meaning that a quarter of a heart is equivalent to 1 HP, a translation that'll be very important throughout the entire video. This means that Link starts off the game with a mere 12 HP, or 3 hearts, and can go all the way to 120 HP, best represented by 30 hearts. Enemies, on the other hand, deal damage to the player mainly based around one hidden stat, referred to as their base damage, which is the unarmed attack power of an enemy that varies between tier and type. A Wipe-A-Coblin, for an example, has a base damage of 24, so when one of them attacks a player via unarmed strike, they will lose 24 hit points, also known as 6 hearts. However, for enemies that can hold a weapon, the attack value of the weapon will be added to the enemy's base damage to create their final damage output. So if the Wipe-A-Coblin is holding a soldier's broadsword, which has 14 damage, this damage will be added to the 24 base damage to now deal 38 damage per strike, or 9.5 hearts, making these guys far more deadly than before. Fortunately though, a lot of this enemy damage can be blocked out using armor, and the math to figure it out is all fairly simple. Whatever your current armor rating is, which is visible from your armor screen, is simply subtracted from the enemy's total damage output to create a reduced damage output. So if we have an armor rating of, let's say, 28, when facing the earlier Wipe-A-Coblin that had a damage output of 38, the 28 armor rating is subtracted from the 38 to create a new damage output of 10, or only 2.5 hearts, represented by the formula you saw on screen. Knowing this, it may seem plausible to try to get the armor rating to even higher than the enemy's attack output to theoretically ignore all their damage, but this just isn't the case at all. This is because the game has a hidden rule set into play, where if the armor rating matches or exceeds the enemy's attack output, the blow will still deal 1 hit point worth of damage to ensure that no enemy attack will be rendered meaningless. But regardless, armor can really mean a lot to ensuring your survival in this world, except this basic understanding only just scratches the surface of the intricacies behind this system. So when talking about enemies' base damages earlier, we mentioned that the Wipe-A-Coblin has 24, but since these are all hidden values, it's best to go over more of them to understand how they work. The base damages for most Bokos, Moblins, and Lizalfos are pretty straightforward, as tier increases their damage output significantly, from a low of 0 all the way to 48 for some. I'll have the full list of enemy base damage values in the description if you care to check it out. But a lot of the other enemies have specific rules set into play that change how their base damages can affect a player. Octoroks, for an example, deal a fairly low amount of damage ranging from 1 to 4 depending on type, but their attacks are one of the few that ignore armor completely. And for the Guardian Scouts, specifically the ones with weapons, completely ignore their own base damage when attacking the player and instead just attack with the value of the weapon they're using, as the base damages only apply to their standard beams and their spin attack moves. On top of some of these hidden rules, some enemies also have multiple different base damages representing their different attacks. Lynels have normal base damage ranging from 15 to 60, representing the value of damage that gets added to the weapon they use, but they also have a secondary base damage called Charge, which dictates how much damage they do when they charge at a player, ranging all the way from 37 to a meaty 150. And lastly for now, the infamous Guardians actually have two different base damages for their laser. One for the beam itself, which deals 52 damage, and another for the beam's fiery explosion, which deals 6. Both are actually very interesting, as the beam portion can be reduced by armor, but only down to a minimum of 8 for some reason, and the 6 damage fiery explosion can't actually be reduced by armor at all, making the lowest possible damage against these guys with high armor only 14, or 3.5 hearts, which is still kinda high considering we can get just about all their attacks in the game reduced to just a quarter. However, this is because there are more ways to reduce enemy damage other than just the armor stat, specifically involving other special defense buffs. In the case of Guardian type enemies, you can use the Guardian Resist buff, which reduces the damage against all their types by 20% for a level 1 buff, 30% for a level 2, and 50% for a level 3, which all gets calculated after the armor points are already applied. This also helps against the Guardian beam damage, but if you already got the damage down to 8, then there's no way to get it lower even with that buff. But alternatively, there is a way to reduce the explosion damage, as it can actually be completely nullified by the fireproof set bonus on the Flamebreaker armor, which when paired with the high enough level flame suit, can make it so you're only taking 8 points of damage per laser, and that's it, which is ironically better than the ancient armor for blocking them out, and can even help against the extra grass fire damage that usually happens after getting struck, so not bad at all. Although the enemy's extra elemental damage isn't the most punishing thing, the worst thing about it is that it can't be negated via the use of armor points like how base and weapon damage can. But fortunately, it can be negated by using elemental buffs like Freezable or Fireproof, similar to how the Fiery Guardian explosion worked. However, although blocking freeze and fire elementals is pretty straightforward, there are two different things that makes blocking electrical attacks a bit more unique. 1. Electrical damage can also be negated via the shock resistance buffs instead of just unshockable, as a level 1 shock resistance buff makes a player receive a third less elemental damage, level 2 making them receive 2/3 less, and a level 3 buff negates all normal electrical damage. So since this level 3 buff makes you shockproof, why does the unshockable set bonus on this armor exist? Well, fun fact, this set bonus is actually just a weird mistranslation for the lightning proof buff, which is also present on the Thunder Helm, as this buff acts identically to how the Thunder Helm does and completely blocks all electricity and lightning, which usually doesn't get blocked by a level 3 shock resistance buff. But speaking of lightning, how do the stats behind lightning work? Well, similar to how Guardian lasers work, lightning bolts have two separate damaging parts, its base damage and its electricity damage. The base damage is only a mere 9 points, which can all be completely negated with normal armor points, and the electrical damage portion deals 49, which can't be blocked by armor points and only has two other ways to negate it. 1. As discussed, the lightning proof buff, which is self-explanatory, as it blocks out both the electrical and the base damage. And the other way is by having a level 3 shock resistance buff, which reduces the electrical damage from 49 all the way to 25, on top of whatever base damage doesn't get blocked out by armor. Oddly enough though, the level 1 and 2 shock resistance buffs don't do anything against this, but at least the level 3 one helps until you get the better armor or even just the Thunder Helm. But while on the subject of environmental damage, by far the most deadly form of this in the game is fall damage, which can pack quite the punch. But how exactly does this mechanic work in decreasing players' health? This is a question that I get asked a lot, and after doing tons of testing, I made a really unique discovery about it. Fall damage is all relative to the character height of Link, and can all be explained by using his figure. For starters, the maximum amount of distance a player can fall before fall damage starts taking effect, which I like to call the buffer window, is exactly 10 links tall, as anything after is where damage will start taking effect. For reference, this height is equivalent to one whole rung in the Colosseum plus a box, as anything higher will damage the player. So for the fall damage calculation after this, every 1 link worth of distance beyond the 10th link makes you lose a quarter of a heart, all the way up to the 20th link after this buffer, which means that a 30 link high drop will make you lose 5 hearts, or 20 HP. This amount isn't super brutal, especially in the mid to late game, but everything beyond this level is where it gets crazy, as after the 30 link total distance, every extra link will make you lose a whole heart, or 4 HP, which can drain a player super easily. Putting all this together, a player's potential 30 hearts can be wiped out with a single fall using a mere 55 link height, 10 of those being the buffer, 20 of those being the quarter of a heart per link, and the remaining 25 being the 1 heart per link. Which, given just how much this can do, this can make fall damage the highest damage dealing method in the entire game. But luckily, fall damage isn't that much of a threat since the paraglider exists for most of your adventure, but if you really want to get technical, what exactly is the highest amount of damage you can receive in the game besides this, and how much can max armor prevent it? Well, looking back to earlier data, the highest damaging enemy in the game, even more so than the bosses, are Gold Lynels, which have 60 base damage and 150 charge damage. The charge damage is really high, but it doesn't stack with the Lynel weapons like how the base damage does. And in terms of the Lynel's strongest weapon, that would be given to the Savage Lynel Crusher with Attack Up, which can max all the way to 108. So combining their 60 base damage with their 108 weapon damage boosts their final damage output to 168, which is way more than a player's hearts that cap at 120. But fortunately, we can block most of this out with armor. With either a maxed out soldiers or ancient set, each piece will give Link 28 armor points, as these can be combined with the champion's tunic, which is maxed out at 32, totaling to 88 defense. But on top of this, there's also one other way to boost Link's armor points that we haven't talked about, which is the defense buff, which works the same way as armor, but its values are hidden. A level 1 buff gives plus 4 armor points, a level 2 gives plus 12, and a level 3 gives plus 24. So with a level 3 armor buff, the 24 points get added to the 88 to create 112 armor points, which when subtracted from the enemy's attack, makes the strongest possible enemy attack in this game with max armor deal a mere 56 damage, or 14 hearts, which I would say is quite the reduction. But lastly, and definitely not least, there is still one defensive tactic in this game left to discuss that can save you from a lot of the deadly blows, which is the anti-one-shot mechanic. Basically, this is a hidden mechanic in the game where if you get hit by an enemy that would usually be able to one-shot you, like a powerful Lynel, as long as your hearts are maxed out, you will almost never die from this hit and instead just be left with a quarter of a heart. The downside of this is that this mechanic is only present on this game's normal mode and not on Master, probably to fit this mode's more punishing nature. But other than that, that is basically all the knowledge that I have to go over today about health and defense stats in the game. So I just want to thank you all so much for watching. If you're curious to know more about the partner topic to this, attack stats, then feel free to check out the video in the card in the upper right, going over all player damage stats in the game, where we even figure out the maximum amount of player damage possible, which I highly recommend. But if you enjoyed the video, please feel free to leave a like and subscribe if you haven't already for more stats related content to come. It's odd to think that this video is already my 12th in the Stats of the Wild series so far, but there is still plenty more of this content in the works, and feel free to check out my other videos if you haven't already. Also, a huge shout out to my amazing YouTube members who help support the content. If you would like to help me out here for exclusive channel and livestream perks, feel free to check out the info in the description below. But anyways, thank you all so much for watching, and I hope to see you all soon. Goodbye!